need to record.
You mute your thing so you can't hear the clips that I play. So I was playing the theme song to open the show.
Oh, right. And
now,
cool.
Now we have to either make this interaction really interesting or I'm going to have to edit it out. So you
I think we should make this interaction really interesting.
Okay, then let's – how do we do that?
I think we should monetize 100% of our interactions, which is like basically what we do.
Yeah. I mean, is it monetized? It's free. The episode is free. We've got no sponsors.
That's true. It's not really. Yeah, wow. I just want everyone to like look at us at all times. Maybe that's it.
We want to like, we are basically constantly forcing ourselves to do things for the payment of exposure. I mean, it's kind of the incredible thing. Welcome to 155.
Welcome to 155.
And today we are saying thanks for Mmrs to FOBruary, the greatest month of our lives, I think. I mean, I have loved FOBruary, the month of talking about Fall Out Boy. I've not grown in any enthusiasm for this band. I think they're awful. And I love talking about things that I think are awful. So if anything, I've regressed even more as a person.
I have developed more of an appreciation for this band, if not a enjoyment of. It's been really fun to talk to people who love them and try to kind of understand where they're coming from. But more than anything, I think it's been fun to talk about a band that just has such a like rich sense of bullshit, because we've had fun with like some of the theme months we have not had any fun with at all. And I don't know that I thought FOBruary was going to be a high watermark for the new pod, but I kind of think it has been. So thanks for the memories.
Thanks for the memories. Thanks for the memories. Well, we'll talk about it, but you must love this song because you hate vowels.
The disembowelment part of the podcast is going to be substantial. In fact, that's going to be most of what we talk about. So let's not, don't jump ahead too quickly.
But first, don't talk for a few seconds.
Okay.
Yep, it's punk news, a thing that we invented where we learn about kind of like, I would say if there was a subtitle for this section, it would be called The Real Punk News. Maybe that could be our Twitter @ for this.
That's interesting. Okay, I'll take a look and see if that's available later.
I think you should go first with this week's punk news, and I'm going to crack a bev.
Well, that's great. While you're cracking, I'm snapping off webs. That's right. We're talking about comic books with my punk news this week. This comes from Bleeding Cool, my favorite website for all the coolest, bloodiest news. Yeah, my favorite website for bleeding. That would be BMEZ, which I feel like has come up a little bit recently.
Is Bleeding Cool like one of these blogs that is from like the late 80s and they've just never updated? Or I'm thinking of Ain't It Cool News that I used to read when I was trying to aggregate movie news stories for work. And it's like, it's just written in like the weirdest, like horny alt weekly guy voice where it seems like he's pulling his pud while typing and like, oh, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm just getting that vibe this headline is, oi, 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 Spider-Punk gets his own series in April.
Yeah, so big news in the world of punk and comics. So Spider-Punk, I guess, exists in the entire Spider-Person metaverse that we've all been introduced to thanks to Oscar-nominated film, Spider-Man into the Spider-Verse.
Doesn't everything exist? Isn't the whole point of a metaverse that every conceivable thing exists? So there is like also a neo-Nazi skinhead Spider-Man to go with the oi, oi, oi thing? Like, doesn't that mean that
there
also
is a Nazi Spider-Man?
I mean, isn't the point of the metaverse that any possible thing you could imagine exists?
Yeah. It looks like I'm at least seeing some fan edits that make Spider-Man into a bit of a Nazi.
A bit of one?
Here's one where he's just a slight Nazi. There's one with just Hitler's face photoshopped on top of the suit. So look, I mean, it's out there. I guess there's then a world where you and I are Spider-Man, maybe together, like maybe in some sort of
like we're like a society two boys style. On top of each other's shoulders.
Yeah, exactly. We're a very tall Spider-Man
in a trench coat.
Yeah. So recently, Marvel announced that Spider-Punk, who I guess has never had their own comic, is getting a miniseries. So Punks, I mean, you can take a look at Spider-Punk here. There's a great photo. I mean, it looks incredibly sick.
Never mind the bollocks style, like text as well, a logo that kind of looks like the ransom note. I know Spider-Punk because I played the Spider-Man video game for PlayStation, and you could unlock the Spider-Punk skin.
Oh, wow.
And you bet your ass I did.
Did you, gravitate towards?
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course I did. How could I not?
That's very exciting. So it looks like this is coming in April. So pretty soon, who knows what you and I will be talking about in April 2022. But one of the things that the internet will be abuzz about, of course, is this new Spider-Punk. So for people who haven't played the PlayStation game, he's sort of chilling on a wall. It's the classic Spider-Man that you know and love, except he's wearing red chucks and like a battle vest, throwing the horns, got a studded belt, some studded bracelets, got a fucking mohawk.
He looks like a fucking loser, honestly.
He looks fucking cool as shit. I'm going to start dressing like Spider-Punk.
He looks like a guy, he looks like a metal vlogger who is...
Oh, for sure.
Like, but who also has like a side channel about... interpersonal polyamory politics or something.
You know what's amazing is like I know exactly like you're not even riffing, you're just talking about a specific person. I think every metal vlogger is polyamorous.
I
for
think
sure.
So. Yeah. And I can't wait for Spider-Punk, but yeah, who knows, in April we might not even be talking about punk anymore.
That's true. Things could change.
Things could change. Hopefully. Well, you know,
but we will be talking about polyamory, so we'll find a way to do it for sure.
Spider-Punk is exciting, and we also kind of touched on racism a little bit. I'm not sure if this is full R racism. I need to actually hedge for a second while I find my original source material for this. But I have so many.
Is this
going to
be like last week's punk news where I was like, "So the truck? Okay, grooming, sexual assault,
No, it's like you know, a few months ago. People freaked out because a white lady had written a cookbook on how to cook like Asian noodles or something. And people were like, I don't know if you should be allowed to do this. And I feel like it's not really, I don't really feel like I have a horse in this race or whatever.
I've just never cooked. That's why I don't cook because I don't believe in any type of appropriation.
Oh, that's smart. That's really smart.
I can never be accused.
You better not be drinking water because that's from people need that all over the place.
That's true.
You're stealing valor liquid.
Walt. No, there's absolutely nothing there. You should pull up right now.
So this is from what I can tell, it's an all white staff, and it's a new restaurant in Nashville that is a sushi izakaya, American izakaya place in West Nashville. And it's called Punk Walk.
I'm really interested in this.
So it's kind of a new place that just opened after being a Germantown pop-up in West Nashville. On March 2nd, we were doing the food photography for our promotional campaign. That was the last day we were in Silo, says Clay Greenberg about his Asian-inspired pub. It was a disaster followed by months of work to close out that business, but the pandemic gave me the time to take a breath, regroup, and consider the next thing. That's when I decided Punk Walk should be more than a pop-up. I mean, just saying the name of the restaurant already feels kind of...
I don't... Like, when you said it, I was like, ooh! Like, I kind of got a chill where you're like, someone said something that they should not have said.
Yeah.
And I was like, and as discussed, I am tied to you Spider-Punk style.
It's true.
So just please be careful. You misstep, I misstep.
What else? I decided to call it an American izakaya, as this Japanese word for pub truly fits, says Greenberg. It's located in Sylvan Supply, just blocks from his home. His cousin Greg Ibanez, also a pretty funny name.
Wow, metal. All right.
That's a very metal vlogger name, in my opinion, Greg Ibanez. He designed the contemporary look of the space with pops of red and black, highlighting a central bar and a length of seating along a section mirrored wall. There's a build. Someone did the build out. 6,400 mahjong tiles form a compelling centerpiece on the wall behind the bar, which is well stocked with sake and Japanese whiskeys. On the back wall is a mural with a quote from punk rocker Johnny Rotten: "Don't accept the old order. Get rid of it." So I guess they've switched the order to be something to do with ordering, you know, food from the restaurant punk. Walk. I'll just try to space them out more. That might help.
Yeah, I think when you do that, when you just got to make it clear.
That's what I'm saying.
Or just say the restaurant that goes by the name. I'm not even going to say it. I don't like it.
Yeah, so you found the Instagram, which again is kind of, you know, it's funny. America. I was looking at their Instagram earlier, and even when I was in, you know, I'm going to keep talking about being in America a couple weeks ago for a long time because it's just, I've just America done something. Once, eh? I've just
yeah, leaving put my in your Instagram bio.
Leaving you know? My house is like, just has been incredible. But I have noticed that a lot of like gastropub places that are trying to be hip are really still using the typewriter font, which makes me think it's very Gen X to like pay a lot of money for gastropub type food. Cause they have used the Gen X font. It seems like it's very fucking expensive, punk walk.
you know what, though? There was a restaurant around the corner from me that never even opened, but that looked like this really trendy spot. And it had the, like, type. I was like, oh, that font, eh? We're still using
that?
Yeah,
I know. I can't believe it. I remember when that was, like, Save On Foods in Western Canada. They used that font to be, like, the edgy grocery store. But yeah. Otherwise, so I was curious if anyone was mad about this, but it hasn't happened yet. But I was reading some of the Google reviews.
I don't know that Nashville is exactly like attuned to
exactly
anything.
But maybe, I mean, eventually, I think things might get punk woke for punk walk, to be honest. But for now, it's mostly people complaining, as Gen Xers do, that things were too expensive for the portion sizes. So there are a few negative reviews. Alexandra, a month ago, right? If you're looking to get takeout from punk walk, be prepared to pay upwards of $20 a roll for a run-of-the-mill miniature sushi roll. And as a bonus, deal with unfriendly, unhelpful staff service and pay a takeout fee. So you can drive to them, wait for your food, drive it home in a standard brown bag, nothing worth the fee they charge, without any sauces, napkins, etc. Sincerely disappointed.
Damn, sincerely disappointed.
Yeah, there's just, I mean, she just goes on and on. And, you know, the response from the owner was, "One star is a little harsh for a restaurant that's only been open 8 days, but we take your concerns seriously and have made adjustments. To be fair and honest, though, the most expensive roll is $17, not $20. I mean, $17 for sushi, isn't that a lot for, like, one item? Seems a little steep. I don't know. I also think,
I just order, like, trashy, like...
Yeah.
I've had nice sushi twice in my life. I'm like, this is amazing. And then whenever I want sushi, I'm just like, give me the trashiest mackie you can get. Like, jam. Like, just shovel dynamite rolls into my face.
Yeah. Like that's all I want.
That's
all you really need. But, you know, I also was just thinking, like, anytime I read a negative review, I'm like, man, this person is fucking entitled. They're just doing their jobs. But this is for a place called Punk Walk, first of all, which I think, you know, they probably could use a little bit of someone sticking it to them. And second of all, as I get older and realize how much kind of my generation is less likely to complain to the manager because we don't want to seem like Karens, I have also noticed recently, including actually today, I walked to the grocery store and got a fresh loaf of bread for lunch, and I ate the end piece, and it had a long black hair inside of it. And that's just, I've like, in the last year, I've had so much hair in my food, and I still feel guilty even noticing it. I feel like I should just swallow the hair.
This is on me.
Yeah, like,
they made this hair special.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I don't know. It's kind of, it's making things very hairy out there. Anyways, real quick, this is 1 hour long. I thought we could just watch a little bit of Chef Grant Smith on a live stream with Nashville Food Site to talk about his new restaurant.
This is my favorite time. And every time that you go live, there's like this 20-second span where I like to just let people come on and let them know what's going on. But it always, if you're watching this video right now on YouTube or Facebook later like, on, you're going to see all this name? And go, what Fuck. The hell are we doing?
Righteous Gemstones?
Oh, yeah, so, Danny McBride?
No, not Danny McBride. Not the guy in the top right looks like...
I'm going to add into the comments section.
No, so it's definitely not...
actually join the really show like live with us.
No, he does. Hold on.
So we go live. I like to put in...
What's like Eddie Patterson's husband? So
people
husband? Want
to come in and join the show live, that they're guy. Welcome to do so.
Can you picture this like his cool brother?
Yeah. Okay, I see it.
What's that sound?
Thank you. This is a terrible live stream.
They've got no... They is need some like headphones.
A, what does it sound like?
Like a thing or something.
I just love that that press release, like specifically, was like
you hear it, Jen,
Nashville's had yeah, like a really always yeah, had an amazing Asian food scene, and it was like scrolling that Instagram. I was like, Smet. Like I don't want to erase anyone, but
anyway, let's get this thing going. You ready, Grant?
Yeah, ready.
All right, we are so excited today to welcome in Chef Grant Smith. He is the chef of the brand new Punk Wok.
He spaced it out too.
How's it going? Doing good. You doing all right?
Yeah, man, we're doing great. We love it. We are live right now.
Jen in the chat has not said anything yet.
Facebook page. We never go live. This is not something we normally do, but it is a Friday. Is it Friday? It is Friday, right?
I believe so. Yeah.
I don't know.
Like, what the hell
we gotta, stop. Is it Friday? Could it be? I think maybe. No more.
All right, let's leave the segment.
Move on to the song.
Okay, here we go. It's kind of like saying punk rock, but changing it to. I mean, do you even use a wok to make sushi? That's the other question.
No, that's the thing. It's a real just like...
So I don't think that's a thing, right?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know about any of this. So we're talking about thanks for the memories.
I've been thinking about this for a long time.
there's a lot to contemplate. This, of course, is the third single from the third studio album. I'm literally reading verbatim from Wikipedia. The third single from the third studio album, the band Fall Out Boy, now I'm making it my own, Infinity on High. Yeah,
so. Sometimes I like to put episodes out on Friday, but today we're just going to go live on Friday, and we are talking, I want to learn so much
so
about
what you guys are doing. So they've determined that it's Friday. They
agree
that it's Friday.
Let's get to the immediate, you have a pop-up this Saturday at the Honey Tree.
You want to hear more people say the word?
From 6 to 10.
I just love it. I just make me a supercut that's like 3 days long of people trying to figure out audio issues of the start of live streams.
On live streams?
It's so good. Thanks for the memory. So let's start with that because
that's
I
really
know,
the what's the this, memory of
what's
of,
the
what's of
the
a live stream.
What's the vowel thing?
So the vowel thing is apparently a response to their label. This feels like some bullshit because, like, at this point, they're one of the biggest rock bands in the world. But their label was like, your titles are too long, fellas. And so this is like a bit of a cheeky, I don't know, wink at the fact that they are known for these verbose titles. I mean, for example, the singles on either side of this are This Ain't a Scene, It's an Arms Race, and The Takeover, The Break's Over. So Thanks for Your Memories is a more succinct song title.
But like they recorded it all at the same time, right? So or you think last minute they're like, let's drop the vowels.
I guess, yeah. I mean that sort of makes sense. Just like a little clever. Now this is like in 2007, which is like maybe when this sort of hit its kind of trendiest.
I feel like that feels late to me. I mean, when was
well?
Mercer
no, it's not
craft?
Actually. It's not craft. Because. So first of all, I had never actually known what the term for this is, which is disemvoweling, which is honestly sick.
I thought you were just being really clever and quick.
I absolutely am not. I believe it was first notably used in Finnegan's Wake by James Joyce. So I'm ripping off Joyce here, but no, 2007. It's kind of still breaking out because it is. Only in 2008, that Time magazine names disemboweling as one of the 50 best inventions of 2008. And so it sits, disemboweling sat somewhere between high-tech running shoes and the Parava's mono tracer. You can take a look at the rest of
I was just trying times. To see if it was in our, if our friends over at the Merriam-Webster Corporation had touched it, but it doesn't look like they have. But, I mean, let's address the elephant in the room, which is that they're playing off of disemboweling, right? Which, like, that means
quite
that
violent, can't condone it.
Your bowels have been
Someone has dissed your bowels.
Right, which I do quite regularly.
That's really what it means. Honestly, I love reading about this stuff. Does just make me feel like I'm listening to like some particularly brutal metal. Disembowelment or evisceration is the removal of some of the organs and gastrointestinal tract, the bowels or viscera, usually through a horizontal incision made across the abdominal area. Disembowelment may be from an accident, but has also been used as a method of torture and execution. Yes! Like, this fucking rocks, man.
This time thing that you sent me, which is not secure also, but it's the 2008 list of best.
I apologize for sending you an unsecure link.
This to me seems like one of those things where it's like a list that you would read on McSweeney's, where you're like, is this supposed to be humor or not? Is this humor?
No, it has
McSweeney's non-humor energy, but I think it might, some of these things, like Einstein's fridge, Facebook for spies.
Yeah, but also Hulu.com, yeah, the like, Chevy what? Volt, the Tesla Roadster.
What is
The new Mars rover. Check it out. They got Montreal's public bike system. Bixies, man.
Is that in 2008? Really?
I guess, eh? Look, this is a celebration of your people.
Yeah, it was. So, I mean, how did they decide that? So this song predates the invention of disemboweling?
Well, no, as discussed, James Joyce invented disemboweling.
Right, I'm sorry,
but,
of course.
But this is sort of where it hits its apex, because it sounds like this is sort of like obviously like obviously an internet thing, but at least according to Wikipedia, they credit Boing Boing with really popularizing it, and then Gawker allowing disemboweling as a moderation tool. Like, I don't even understand all this, but evidently they do quote the coolest person on Twitter, Zenny Jardin. I've never tried to pronounce their name. But said of the practice, this is a quote, the dialogue stays, but the misanthrope looks ridiculous and the emotional sting is neutralized. I guess this is about sort of using it to kind of censor some bullshit. I don't really know. I don't really care too much about that. But the point is, the Washington Post did it. Anyway, this was like, a real, like, they are on the vanguard of it. Like, New York Times was writing about it in 2008. This is basically just a backlash to Fall Out Boy.
I think, but doesn't this seem like a scenester thing? Like, wouldn't this have also happened on like Makeout Club or something, or obviously MySpace and stuff? Like, it must be, there must be some scenester prerequisite before the normies over at Boing Boing got their nasty little fingers all over it.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like, I would love to know, like, who's the first band? Because, okay, Mersterkurft is 2005. MGMT, but that's like, that was always like, that's more of a...
Yeah, that's kind of a...
I feel like it's all Mersterkurft, maybe.
There must be... Right? I don't know. I mean, we should... I think we should just watch this punk walk live stream instead of talking about this.
That's fair. So look, disemboweling a big part, but I would like to know, Josiah,
Power from Bottom, Subtract, but those are like more newer, I think.
I think so.
A lot of canceled bands with no vowels. That's interesting.
It is interesting. And of course, like, that's why I'm waiting to be canceled, because,
that's the thing. And I was looking at your Twitter right now. And I know you don't tweet.
As you should be.
You don't tweet very often these days. However,
no.
I find it stressful.
I am very, very
pleased to be catching up to you with follower count. That's been a grind.
Feel finally right, because like you being like active, you know, I think an example of you know, a good user of the platform, right? And you just sort of languishing with like half the followers I had while I once a week would be like, oh, the pod, or like Hot Water Music, listen to it right now, still rips, you know?
Yeah, it's really strange.
And you're there doing these like elaborate bits. You've got your friends with all these important people on it and just like...
I know.
It is embarrassing, but I actually saw that recently. I saw it. So congratulations. Have you passed me?
No,
yet?
I haven't. I need some follow. Everyone listening,
what do you think it's going to take?
I don't know, but anyways.
Everyone follow Friday Josiah.
You haven't you haven't been on Twitter as long either. So you joined in 2011 and you and then that also makes me wonder, was it a hedge on your part? Because you still put the vowel in your first name, but then no vowels in your last name. That's just
I know.
Is already taken? Let me check.
So
no, doesn't exist. You could have gone.
That just seemed
no
too crazy. I think that was too much. I struggled because I originally like in a very old married people with the same email account way basically had, because I thought Twitter was fucking stupid. So Ashley and I had a Twitter account.
It's life.
No, I was wrong.
Twitter
I was wrong.
Is
Don't
life
worry.
Or death.
I had a joint Twitter account for Juicebox, which was like our website, the blog / like pay what you can record label. And so we had Juicebox as a Twitter account. And then at some point I was like, oh, I kind of want my own Twitter. And so I spun that off and Ashley kept the Juicebox one, which now is her Twitter account is the old Juicebox one. So technically, and I don't know how long Ashley's been on Twitter for, that account is when I joined Twitter. But in 2011, I think I was like really into that band Virgins, which like sometimes they spelled their name Virgins. And it was just like generally in the zeitgeist. And I couldn't get Sam Sutherland. I didn't want to do like something kitschy. It just seemed like the right solution. I do regret it, but
why do you?
I'm not
saying you should regret it. I'm saying it's
well,
kind
it's
of...
confusing to be like Sam Sutherland. Only Sutherland has no vowels. Like, you right. know, if I do another podcast, people are like, so are you on Twitter? I'm like, yes, it's stupid.
Yeah. Well, you should just be saying either the pod's Twitter handle or just mine, I think.
Just, you could check me out at Josiah Hughes.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I think it's annoying that they did this on this song title, but I also think that's good in a way because it, like, this song is pretty annoying. And what I'm realizing now is that I find Fall Out Boy songs really annoying, and then I start liking them during the chorus, and then that makes me even more angry. And that's what happens
yeah.
with this song.
So I will also say, like, I still disavow, like, almost all the playlists that, like, the playlist names that I make, like, just in Apple Music. Like, I generally think disavowing just looks cool. I guess I have not kept up with the vibe shift, and I'm still living in 2007, unfortunately. I think Arcade Fire is cool, and I like my Red Wing boots. But I had the same thought listening to this is, first of all, did you know this song was produced by Babyface?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, so two of the songs on this record are produced by Babyface, which is like incredibly sick. And part of that, evidently, the sort of grandiosity of this song was, you know, Babyface telling Fall Out Boy to just like think and go as big as possible. But in watching the video right before we got on this call, I really felt like, it's like, oh, the chorus is when they just like drop out and it's like the big kind of chorus, it's just the drums. I was like, that's fucking cool. And the drum part when it's like bop, 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 bop,
yeah,
like the triplet
yeah,
fill,
yeah.
I was like, oh,
because cool.
that. It makes it sound really human in a way, like that's such a like drummer thing to do
that's
that I
true.
Feel like you wouldn't hear in a like Maroon 5 song today, or you wouldn't hear in a Coldplay song. It's like a real like I'm doing the energetic. Like,
yeah, it. They sound like
it's fucking sick.
The chorus does make them sound like some friends rocking out in the garage, and
totally.
I hate to admit it, and it hurts
know,
me to admit it,
know,
but it's true. It's very true.
But I even find, like, looking at the lyrics right now, I despite having heard the song enough, I can't even conjure the vocal melody right now. Like, it's just totally gone for me. But the chorus is, like, is legitimately fucking sick.
Is every Fall Out Boy song just, like, taking Bible references and then, like, horny
incel reference? Is memories a biblical concept?
Well, they're just talking about say a prayer in case God doesn't show. I mean, it's not really biblical, but it seems like they do love to play with, you know, religion and then talking about, I'm going to make it bend and break. I assume that's his dick that he's snapping off inside
yeah.
someone.
Yeah, this is about breaking your dick. thanks for the memories of before my dick was broken.
Well, it is. Yeah, like... I don't know. I feel like it's just interesting because this song is kind of the two halves of Fall Out Boy. Because there's like the annoying Panic at the Disco theatrical bullshit that I'm never going to like. And then the rock and emo band part. And I think the chorus actually is better than all of that early Fall Out Boy that we were listening to as well. Like, it's just good. It's just straight up good. And that's so frustrating.
Yeah, that's the thing is, like, I can sense a version of a song or a band kind of, like, coming through that I am interested in.
And it's like, imagine that you, like, have really good taste in everything, in the finer things in life.
Don't have to imagine.
You're on a business trip, and you're just like, I want to have the best of the best. And so you kind of do your research online. You look around. You read all the blogs, all the reviews. I need the best. And then after like hours of deliberation, you realize that where you are, Nashville, the best sushi you can possibly get is Punk Walk.
Don't fuck, man. That's true. That's kind of, I was worried you were going to start playing. Don't fucking do it, man. I can see that it's still open in the watch together. And I'm there.
That's just in case. I mean, it's kind of like you better keep saying interesting shit or else we're watching.
I know, right? Look, okay. I mean, we're looking at the genius. We're kind of talking about the song. You know, this feels like this is another Fall Out Boy song about breaking your dick, obviously. But I will say the one thing that always kind of jumped out at me that I thought was cool, and I think it's interesting that it gets put in quotes because it's like a movie quote or whatever, is like the "he tastes like you only sweeter" line. Because reading it in context and like reading about it, like, oh, it's supposed to be this like dialogue and that's what the woman is saying or whatever to the masculine Patrick Stump, is like, it always kind of struck me as fucking kind of sick that this band had like what felt at least like sort of sexually ambiguous lyrics in a sex song.
Right.
And evidently, like, Pete Wentz has said, this was like a quote. I actually have lost it. I can't find it because who fucking gives a shit?
Well, we can watch him talk about the lyrics because he actually did it one of those genius.com videos.
Do you want to watch that?
Yeah, we may as well watch a little bit. Let me just hit play here.
Yes, we do. Okay.
doing that? What's it going to be?
Well, honestly, I don't know if you guys have ever been to that place, Honey Chew Meadery. A couple of buddies of mine own it. It was the first real meadery here in Nashville.
Okay, here we go. Let's watch fucking...
It's just like that line you walk between like belief and not believing and bending.
I will say I've definitely been Pete like Wentz pilled in terms like, of thinking that he God, is like don't want to, you know, like incredibly
whatever.
Handsome.
But then you like get off the plane so and you're like, I'm cool. Chill. Like, I don't need, like,
yeah, kinda, like he just know, seems whatever. Like a really
it's, like,
nice dude.
That like belief, you know what I mean?
I think I thought he was like insanely corny and responsible.
I do want to talk about
the downfall of culture.
I do want to talk about him a little bit in a second.
Like when
but
you're part of this the punk rock scene, you like create all these rules, you know, or whatever.
Yes.
And it was so refreshing to hear something where like those rules like just didn't apply.
Did he say punk walk scene?
I'm going to make it bend and break, say a prayer, but let the good times roll in case God doesn't show. I'm like the kind of guy that like really wants to believe. I don't really know. Oh, you know, like I go back and forth
what
I believe and stuff.
Oh, shit,
I have a
man.
Really hard time with like
saying, also, I got to say, you know, even when the car said it, God bless Rick Ocasek, saying let the good times roll is pretty cringy. And I think using it in here as well, I don't like it at all.
If I can't feel it, it's hard for me, you know, but like there's plenty of things that you can't feel that exist. And I want these words to make things right, but it's the wrongs to make the words come to life. I'm a neurotic person, you know? And like I feel like I have like a
He's
lot
an
of-
He's an erotic person.
Erotic.
People, but it's hard for me to like-
This is a great jacket.
Engage it, you know, whatever. It's like all happens in my
it's
head.
It's like
kind
a
of, you know?
Sheepskin
so,
kind of jean
like,
jacket.
Just, like, go over the situation over and over.
Covered,
like,
in covered in butterfly patches.
Covered in butterfly patches. Like, it's tight.
Who does he think he is? If that's the worst that you got, okay, you better put your fingers back to the keys.
Like all
whatever
the,
you've gone
through. Is
this
what it's like to listen to the podcast,
this is, like,
man?
Gets I'm you to here. You know what I mean? Like, and so,
every Fall Out Boy song is
like, from this moment
feels like the Weezer writing method.
How you're going to be.
Yeah, it's true, right?
Informed.
Like, I have a database of words with different syllables.
One night, one more time.
Okay, yeah, I do think
thanks
this is a
memories,
cool chorus.
Even though they weren't so great, he tastes like you.
Thanks for
sweeter.
The memories, even
it's
though
like
they weren't so great, it's pretty
whole
good.
Idea of like FOMO, you know, like when you're like not out and you're like looking at people's Instagram or whatever and you're like, oh man, I should be there. It'd be so like amazing. And then you're like there and you're like, it's like kind of amazing. It looks more amazing on Instagram though. Like looking at Coachella, I'm like, Coachella looks so amazing. But I'm like, dude, I'd be sitting in like a hot, dusty line right now probably. One night, one more time.
No,
thanks
be.
For the memories.
Oh, so
thanks for
the I feel
memories.
Like he's not even addressing that he tastes like you only
it's
sweeter.
It's like that thing where you're like really want somebody to tell you everything about a situation.
Which I think
you know,
is interesting.
And like they do and you're like, well, I didn't really actually
he
want
sounds
to
like he's
that
describing
much.
A completely different song. Look,
I know, but so in previous interviews, he's talked about that he tastes like you only sweeter line being a reference to the movie Closer, which I am not familiar with, although Natalie Portman and Clive Owen were nominated for supporting acting, their supporting acting roles at the Oscars and the Golden Globes. So to like have a song that has a quote from this movie that I'm a little baffled by it. It's
well,
a Mike Nichols movie.
You know, he likes to quote things because he just like, you know, like he quoted, this is the album I think where he heavily quoted American
right.
Nightmare. So I think yeah. It's kind of like, it just seems like he's just kind of really copying and pasting a lot of shit all the time. And then when he describes what the song is about, you're like, huh? What?
But, yeah.
You know, God, he's so cute that it's kind
he's
of...
He's so cute, he can do whatever he wants, man.
Yeah, it's true.
But again, like, that to me was, like, the idea of... again, because I think my experience with this band was always, like, people who are into this band and dressed like Pete Wentz as a way to gain the affection of women, and that it sort of seemed to play into this, like, very specific type of, like, just, like, dull, bro-y... kind of trying to pick up girls vibe. The idea that this hit again, like would cause those people to be like singing about, you know, guys whose kisses are sweeter. It was like fucking great. I'm just like always, yeah. Always loved that. And I think I've like grown, even just like watching the video, I was like, the one just belting this shit out. Like, it's just really great.
Yeah.
And again, putting it in quotes to try to project around it, but again, not addressing it there. I'm like, I wonder if the quote was just sort of a deflection. And I think that's fucking...
He kind of seemed... He had the energy of being in a job interview and someone saying, yeah. What is the tangible time that you solved a problem at work? And then he just kind of like started talking and didn't know what to say. That's kind of what I felt from that.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
So let's talk... you just sent me something. I mean, that's really the real... The other big elephant in the room... is
well,
not
elephant
an elephant,
is,
but
yeah.
A dang reality television star. Kim.
I was going to, no, wait, how about this? It's not an elephant. It's a chimp, because that's the other
thing. Oh,
that's
thing,
true. Right?
That is true. And you're not saying,
I thought you were going to go,
you're not saying that she, that Kim, I call her Kim Kardashian, because of what
wow.
The cult,
well, what are you, John Oliver here?
What is a Kardashian? What's a Kardashian? Remember when that was the thing people would say? What's a Kardashian?
I bet I could still find it. I want to look up latest tweets for what's a Kardashian right now. So this video features not only chimps, but Kim Kardashian. There's no rhyme. There's nothing. A lot of real failed attempts. At, like, maybe if I talk enough, this will take off. I do love it. And like the band has talked about this in interviews. They're like, we were at the point where like we were a band that was making music videos with
Asher,
like monkey
Asher
actors.
Fulf yesterday. Asher Fulf yesterday,
nice.
As of recording, that's tweeted, "What's a Kardashian? Is it like a scote? Is it like a coat, a scarf, or a sweater or something?" Two faves on that, Asher.
Well, but you're saying the most recent "What's a Kardashian" on Twitter is from a day ago, which I feel like is a good sign for us as a society.
They have been. It's been about one a day. Now, for
cool.
The last
okay.
month.
Well, that's good. That's really good. Good.
That's not bad.
Good for us. Now, if you were wondering what's a Kardashian in 2022, imagine how people might have felt in 2007. I actually really don't know. Like, this is genuinely not to be dismissive. What is Kim like? Is Kim Kardashian just like a model in 2007? Like, what? Or is it like a? Is this a cameo of some kind? I'm going to have to look at the Kim Kardashian Wikipedia now.
Right.
But this video does feature Pete Wentz almost snogging with Kim Kardashian before a monkey director intervenes.
You know what? You must have been distracted because they do eventually land a smooch at the end.
Oh, do they? Okay,
And so the concept of this video is that Pete Wentz is and a monkey are like jealous of each other and kind of competing. Like, that's just an interesting
thing. I think the
monkey
is the director of the video, though, too, right?
Yeah. Doesn't it feel like music videos always kind of as a rule don't have enough of a concept. It's like almost a concept always where you're like, I guess I get it.
I
like,
think there's monkeys, an idea here, but it's not really.
Yeah, like maybe that's why these people just stick to directing music videos usually and don't like, I don't know.
That's why there's literally like two, everyone's like, so many great directors have come from music videos. David Fincher. Also, David Fincher. And look, I know the other answer is Zack Snyder, but that's it. That's it.
I mean, I guess you could argue Spike Jones, but I mean, Lord knows he's not, he's never really doing any, he's just on his own shit, really.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess Michel Gondry, there are quite a few, actually. We shouldn't have gone down this path because there are quite a few.
Sure, but they're not making good movies. Like, no one cares. Just trying to see. So in 2006, Kardashian entered the business world with her two sisters over the boutique Dash. 2007 is when the sex tape comes out. So she is at the peak of, I guess, like an initial blast of like saturated media attention. Because prior to that, it's all stuff that like I wouldn't have known about.
So this is months before, the music video is months before Keeping Up with the K, as us true heads like to call it, came out on TV.
Yeah. Do you watch that show?
I've never watched it.
Do you watch much like of that type of reality?
No, I like Love is Blind, obviously, and I love Terrace House, Love is Blind Japan. Mm. I mean, I think I'm, as with most things in life, I'm pretty pretentious with the reality TV that I consume, and it feels good. Yeah, it feels great.
So Kim Kardashian, again, this is sort of the thing that makes this video kind of, I guess, famous in the band's catalog. And there's like I think Pete Wentz did an interview where he said something effective, and I think this is very funny. Like, this is the last time that they interacted where they were as famous as each other. But more interesting is that Kim Kardashian, I guess, posted on her Snapchat a couple of years ago, rewatching the video and reacting to it. So I just sent that to you because it's kind of cute and funny. It's been reposted by Kim K in style.
My baby, you guys.
I won't be able to hear it, but if you can maybe just
play it. Yeah, it's really fucking loud and I can't turn it down, so I'm sorry.
Everyone. 10 years ago.
You know what's interesting about this is that Kim kind of did. She is setting the stage here for the great Courtney Travis Kravis romance. I mean, this is kind of an early
connecting these two disparate worlds.
Yeah, so that's interesting. I mean, I know that Kim and Travis also had a little thing for a second, but man, they both look so weird in the still from this. That is,
used I know, as right? It's really default. Unsettling. It's a troublesome Maxra's default, but look, there's a making of for this, but like every making of Fall Out Boy music video, it is incredibly boring. It just has the benefit of having apes in it. But more importantly, there's something that I didn't find that you found.
Yeah, I think we need to do that.
Which is way better than any rote-ass making of.
Haven't watched this yet. I don't know if you did.
No, neither have I.
So for those who are not Canadian, get the fuck out of here. This is for Canadians only, this show. So I don't know why you're even here. We tried to get it geo-blocked. But also, video on trial was a thing where, like, it's funny. I feel like it was, like, it seemed like it was struggling up-and-coming comedians on it, right? Pretty much?
Yeah, it was all, because there's a few of the people that were on video on trial, like, have maintained careers as comedians. But it was definitely, like, they paid people no fucking, it's honestly a genius format.
Yeah, I guess it's kind of like Gogglebox in the UK. Or maybe it's like all those like VH1 shows that had like Michael Ian Black on them or whatever.
I love the 90s or whatever. But with less of a budget and therefore like no one you had seen. Like I remember watching Video on Trial once and seeing like a TA that I had at Ryerson and being like, oh, I guess my TA is. And then I saw him in like an ad for something. Now I have not seen him since, so I guess it didn't work out. But I was like, oh shit, my TA is a struggling actor. Good for him.
So here's a Video on Trial talking about Fall Out Boy Thnks from the Mmrs.
Second on the docket, Fall Out Boy's Thnks for the Mmrs. This video is charged with having more product placements than 12 episodes of The Price is Right.
Oh yeah, that was the thing. So it's called Video on Trial, not just because they're mocking it, but then They still had to add some stupid concept. So it was like, this video is on trial for this. It was like they're trying to judge whether or not it's guilty of being too epically lame or whatever.
I mean, just great.
Jurors should note that the monkey just who directed this video is also the lead singer's younger, more attractive brother.
Yeah, this is like here extremely edited. Boy.
Thanks for the memories.
Darren Rose, like Boomer Phillips.
Boomer Phillips. Oh, Deborah Giugiovanni. Yeah.
I think she's still around.
She's a real person, yeah.
I've never seen such a hairy film.
Oh, this lady, too.
Jay Lee's. She's still around.
Not going to lie to you.
Boomer Phillips, though, I do not know.
They do it for me.
He looks like a guy named Perez Hilton. I'm gonna
make it bend and break. Perez Hilton was on this. Oh my god. Let
the good times roll. The lighting in this video is very dark, however, not dark enough to cover up the fact
Boomer
that
Phillips,
the lead singer of this band has less star
Sue
power
today,
than my
the Sue St. Marie
teacher.
Newspaper.
The energy of the band is kind of
really?
Off because is like
he's
clearly like the leader of the band. You know what I mean? It's very almost
he's
famous. Do you remember that when Jason Lee had a beard?
Whoa!
Pete is the one
comedian
rare
and firefighter. Yeah,
that
Boomer
gets
Phillips.
More vagina
I've,
than the lead
you.
Singer.
Because he
good for him. That's a glow up, man.
The band to team up with Pudgy Ugly Guys.
Soft target.
He's calling people Pudgy Ugly Guys on TV.
In 2007, though, that was
is
true. That's all they really
shit.
Knew how to do.
He's going to show the director who the king of the jungle is.
Oh, that's funny.
See what I've done there? I pretended I didn't know it was a monkey.
But these aren't really monkeys. They're chimpanzees. These are evolved monkeys. These are smart monkeys. These are monkeys that
damn, that's like so sad
humans.
That Perez Hilton went on a much music, roasting music video.
Yeah,
show.
Why is Perez Hilton on this show?
I also love how Pete got naked in it. He's obviously comfortable with his body and showing it to the world. We've all seen his penis on my website.
Just bragging about publishing news.
This is actually Ashley Simpson before the plastic surgery.
I wanted to see more peen. Show me the peen all the way.
Perez Hilton is not fully selling it, though.
I really love
I do
how
like
much music was where, like,
the whole Axe body
if you're, like, a D-list American
ad.
Celeb,
anything,
you could host
it
the VMAs
one
13-year-old
boy from
totally.
Spraying an entire
an
can
American
on his
looked
body
at us.
Expecting a hand job.
I'd let that monkey give me a hand job.
What? Is anyone else totally grossed out by that?
A little jungle fever.
What? It's a hand, you know? You throw a dish glove on it, it doesn't count, even if it's a monkey. Judge me if you want.
I'm just kind of, you know, off this video.
Because yeah, I'm like this was post, I think, for both of us, like,
some of you might
watching much all
the
time
internet.
Era.
And if you laugh, you watch.
So this was like a show that I would see kind
I
of accident.
You're not watching this with your parents. Cause
but this was like a fucking hit. Again, I mean, because Much has, like, very specific license requirements. So this was, like, a way to meet them by while basically spending more money. So, again, from a pure,
poor Joe Simpson. Looks like Pete doesn't like other men standpoint. Around his girls, which means father-daughter bra shopping is going to be out.
I can't believe she was out. She should have totally made out with a monkey.
Kind of a moot point.
She should have gotten Tara Reid. Give her a few cocktails.
I think
and
the
she
version
would have been
that I watched of this music video on Vivo did not have monkey subtitles. I think they cropped them out.
I don't remember seeing the monkey subtitles.
The monkey's spying on
so
them while they make
no
out.
No wonder it didn't make
me
any
sense. Me and my buddy spied on my buddy making out with a girl.
So there actually was like a good plot.
He pulled down his pants and started pulling his ass hairs out, and he thought it was the girl, but it was really us.
I just think, and I know this kind of
just pulling his ass
works
hairs out.
Us.
Fantastic.
I don't think you should be allowed on TV if you have a noticeable Canadian accent.
All right, verdict for this video?
4.5 stiff bananas out of 5.
4 bananas out of Pete Wench's bum.
3.5 monkeys throwing feces out of 10.
Very all funny. The people were ugly. 1 on 10.
Funny. I sentenced Pete Wentz to house arrest, and I live at 5, 8.
Yeah, I can see why she's still a star.
Yeah, she was the only one kind of trying to make jokes, actually.
Her and Sabrina were funny. I will give them that.
You know
you can
what?
See why the people who lasted have lasted.
It takes a lot of bravery for us to both admit, but the two female comics were the funny ones.
Yeah, it's hard for me to say that. Now,
hang on, kid, real quick, before we move on to whatever you
keep it quick.
Down, well, it might not be. I'm not going to play it. It's not that. But now I really do want to play that. In fact, it's even the restaurant is the same initials as Pete Wentz. Think about that for a second. But no, we put the video on trial. I really quickly just want to put Pete Wentz on trial because I've always had a suspicion that Pete Wentz doesn't play his own bass. Like, and that's, I'm not the only one who thinks that. Have you seen this before? Does Pete Wentz really play his parts live? It's there's many, many Reddit threads.
You sort of hinted at that because we talked about how he really doesn't look like he's playing bass.
He looks like he doesn't know how to play bass. And like his strumming patterns are like, I feel like, you know, it's not always all downstrokes, but I feel like when you're in a punk band at this point, you would be doing a lot of downstrokes. But he's doing a lot of like, you know, first week of guitar lesson, up and down stroking. And he's always spinning his bass around so much. And there are so many Reddit threads about like, does he actually play bass live? And and someone even said he accidentally bumps his bass against his mic stand here and it makes a sound. So it's obviously on when they play. So, I mean, this is on the Fall Out Boy Reddit, the official Reddit for fans. They're trying to figure it out. I still think that he might not know how to play bass. And I kind of went on a very brief rabbit hole after seeing this video where I was like, he's barely like, he's always swinging it around so much. Cause, and so then I was watching his videos about his precision bass that he released with, I just wanted to, because I think, would Fender really upload a video where it never shows the musician play at all?
I guess if they're famous enough, I mean, Fender's business is selling basses.
Yeah, I guess you're right, but.
Or funny though.
It's like the bass, I guess, you know, it's like, iconic.
Bass is bass, as a wise artist once said.
Stands out for a guitar, you know. It's like,
and here's the thing: first one you know about this shape. Video, it's
like the only one.
And his probably my his favorite signature
bass that I've ever owned was it's a Sunburst. It's like a 57.
So he picks it up briefly in this video to show off. And what I do love about his signature precision bass, as by his own admission in here too, is that he's never liked using any of the tone knobs or anything. And in fact, he used to just remove them from his thing. So he like, his bass only has a volume knob.
My signature bass, but I wanted the...
He made sure that his signature bass would only have a volume knob because he doesn't care about tone or anything, which is already like, I think he would almost be proud of the fact that he can't play and he's been getting away with it in a sense.
I get it. Look at, as we've talked about this before, as someone who's played in a band that is not as successful as Fall Out Boy, but like still toured and done stuff for 10 years and still is not good at guitar, I respect it.
But like this one,
maybe this is why I like Pete Wentz so much.
This one starts with him, like he pretends he's just finished playing bass. That's what I find crazy about it. This is about his...
Oh, sorry. You just caught me in the middle of an intense bass set.
So we have just finished the new Fall Out Boy record.
You can hear the strings,
last touches on it, and one of the things I'm most excited about is that this is the first time I was able to record.
This is pretty standard, though. I think in a lot of bands, like the people in the bands don't play their instruments on the records.
And
well, there's like there's truth there's though that he's not even playing live. That it's either pre-recorded or there's another second band
right now. This has much more to do with like substance issues, but like Arthur Kane from the New York Dolls,
share this, did not play. So. I'm going to,
you know, I think this happens more than from the TV, you know,
600
true Fall Out Boy fans like you and I want to admit.
You should pick up as well. All right, let's sign this bad boy.
So yeah, I mean, this video is, he has it plugged in and then he unplugs it and just and drops the patch cord like dongle first onto the floor to make a like, again, kind of a first day sort of move. I don't know. I just wanted to briefly put him on trial. I don't think we can charge him yet. We haven't made enough jokes about monkeys' asses or whatever that was.
Yeah, but we need to get Boomer Phillips in here. We can really, really get to the bottom of this.
Yeah.
That is interesting.
I guess I'm just asking questions rather than answering them, which is kind of what great podcasters do, usually.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
So look, before we get to covers, you know, I did say to you there aren't a lot of really interesting live videos, mostly because by this point the band's kind of just too big, like they're just normal shows. The only thing that I did like that I thought you might like, there's a video of them playing at the VMAs where they're like sort of in a smaller room and it looks like it's supposed to be like kind of punk, but it's mostly pretty boring. But I did like this. This is Fall Out Boy playing Thanks for the Mummers at I guess MTV Spring Break in 2008.
This is a song you can actually dance to. Well, it's for everybody on the dance floor. We wanted to thank American Eagle for bringing us down here. You guys rule.
That was it. Yeah. That just felt so of a moment to be like, shout out American Eagle. It's like, hell yeah, 2008. Like,
those guys rule.
Yeah, it's a real full-throated endorsement.
You know what we haven't actually watched at all, which we should because it has two songs on it, is we have not watched Fall Out Boy perform at the 103rd Grey Cup halftime show. You just mentioned the VMAs, which, wait, oh, I'm thinking
did they play it? Did they play it at the halftime show?
They did. I was thinking
of we've been talking about this for weeks.
I was thinking, when I said VMAs earlier, I meant MMVAs. That's the Much Music one. So VMAs is American. So they weren't at that level of Struggle CanCon, but they were at the Struggle CanCon level of playing the Grey Cup halftime show. I mean, who else usually plays it? Like, it's probably just usually that band White Horse or whatever.
Yeah, White Horse plays. I mean, this year it was the Arkells.
Right. It's just like,
I love the Grey Cup. Like, I went to the Grey Cup this year.
Been without realizing. I probably was just.
The Grey Cup halftime show. Fall Out Boy definitely, I remember at the time being like, huh. Like, for the 100th Grey Cup, we got Justin Bieber and Psy, which was like. So last year was Keith Urban. The year before that, Alessia Cara. This is much more what you would expect. The year before that was Shania Twain. The year before that was One Republic. And then we got Fall Out Boy. But guess who played before Fall Out Boy at the 102nd Grey Cup? That's right, Josiah. Your friends, Imagine Dragons.
Oh, shit. That's really... This timeline is very strange. But I guess it's because Fall Out Boy must have played Mmrs. Like, it had been out for a while. Because they also play... At the time code I've just grabbed, they also play... Uma Thurman. So let's check them both out.
Fuck yes.
Wait, Sam, you just... Breaking news. Someone just handed you a document. Sorry.
This is important. That I gotta tell you. Look.
Imagine if you were just podcasting at home and somebody slipped... And it wasn't Ashley. If somebody just slipped you a paper with an update.
Under the door?
No, oh just like God. Onto your desk while you're podding. Because I assume you're looking into the computer like you're on TV hosting
I am
news.
Looking into the computer like I'm on
so
TV.
So someone just
I'm
not slid looking you around the room. You didn't even realize and you're like, oh, I've just gotten an update that...
Well, someone did hand me an update. Psy performed at the halftime show of a Bills game in Toronto when they used to do the Toronto series. The 100th Grey Cup was, in fact, Justin Bieber, Carly Rae Jepsen, Marianas Trench, a big part of the podcast lately, and Gordon Lightfoot. And the year before that was Nickelback. So the Grey Cup rocks, but definitely Fall Out Boy. I would say Imagine Dragons, Fall Out Boy, One Republic is... make sense as a group.
That's true. That is true. What if we did Marchiana's Trench? Marianas March.
Don't fucking give it away.
Here's Fall Out Boy at the Grey Cup. I still think that's really... I mean, even to be with One
this
Republic...
This was the Grey Cup
in
Winnipeg, I gotta say. Like, this was not the Grey Cup in a real city.
This is very Struggle.
Oh, wow. This is like a live video? This isn't even the broadcast?
I thought it was the broadcast. Damn, do you see? It's probably like two Canadian Tire dollars.
For sure.
It's like so...
No, dude, the Grey Cup seats are
so
expensive,
cheap,
man.
Though, is it?
This is...
Sarah's dad has season's tickets to the Stamps, and I feel like it's like $10 a decade or something.
Yeah, and look, at regular season, it's affordable. It's a working-class league, but the Grey Cup is one of Canada's biggest, if not Canada's biggest, full stop, sporting event. I would say it's like a very Toronto-centric opinion of you to not care about the Grey Cup, but you've never lived here. How did you not get Grey Cup fever as a Stamps fan?
I wasn't a Stamps fan. I went to a few games because it was, like, cheaper to go than not go. but I thought it was going to be more like Explosions in the Sky or, like, Friday Night Lights, and it wasn't. It's crazy how bad this sounds, and I like this song.
I watched this on TV, and it was, like, I remember thinking it was pretty good because I remember being sort of sad for them. Because at least, like, when Imagine Dragons played the Grey Cup, it was in Vancouver, you know? And when One Republic played, it was in Toronto. They're just in Winnipeg in November.
Is this the song? Is this Memories?
Yeah. The verse doesn't exist in the song.
It's also just, like, why is it... Maybe that explains some of the DeviantArt we were talking about with Miles and Alex on patreon.com/155. But... It does have, like, kind of, like, haunted house. Like, this seems like it could be in a Scooby-Doo movie or something.
Oh, for sure, yeah. I can picture running away from a monster to this.
Before we get into covers proper, I actually think we are going to talk about Psy for a second, because I did have Psy on here. But first, I want to show you, because of the name of this song, I thought there was going to be more of these. There was actually only one that came up, and it's, like, I think a Russian guy used this song just to make this nice slideshow of his wife. It's a really good video.
Oh, wow. I'm gonna make it bend and break. prayer, but let the good times roll. Is this the song?
That's what's confusing to me too. It always doesn't sound like him when it stars. I created this with the YouTube video editor. Says Yuri Semitnyov.
So it's just, we're just watching a vacation video right now.
Well, it's not a video. It's a collection of stills of his wife on vacation. But yeah, thanks for the memories.
We had a really good time. Kind of a rude song, though, I guess, eh?
Yeah, maybe he didn't really... I mean, the lyrics are really confusing. So. Looks like a nice lady, though. Glad,
yeah.
Glad they had that time together.
Yeah, me too.
But then I just was checking out his channel to see what... I also kind of was curious. She has a Herbalife shirt. On vacation, maybe that's how they funded it.
What is Herbalife?
I think it's an MLM scheme. I think it's some sort of. It's like a nutrition scam. I like to say, like vitamins, whatever. But anyways, I just thought maybe she died. Maybe that's what he means. Thanks for the memories. I don't know.
But no, it's memories of the trip.
This other video, same kind of vibe, but it's with, and it even has title Psy Oppa Gangnam Style. Gangnam Star. And it's just pics of the fam, really.
Aw. Man, what a great tune. I feel like as a culture, we've moved on from Psy too quickly.
Yeah, you might be right. This one has a longer caption, so I'm just going to quickly translate it just to see what it is. Text exceeds character limit. Come on.
We'll never know. We'll never know.
For fuck's sake.
But thank you,
Psy. Oh, this
is
actually just copied and pasted Psy's wiki to the video. This one seems to be the user's daughter, though, instead of wife. So we've really gotten to know... Yuri Semitnyov, and I'm thankful for
thanks,
that.
Yuri.
Thanks for the memories. Thanks for the memories. So I think probably to start covers, I think I want to start probably with, let me see, I'm trying to get this working. I think we'll start maybe here.
Will do. So you're at Silo. Let's talk about the origin of punk rock.
Yeah, okay.
Because I love the name. You're at Silo.
We'll
the
end. How does this video end?
Well, hang on. He's supposed to just talk about
Clay,
the name. How they thought of the name.
Oh, okay. Then he was one of the owners of Silo. And
I found
when
this
did
part
punk
while
rock
you
come
were,
about?
Well, you were freaking out earlier about something.
Punk rock originally.
Wow, you weren't listening.
Was
to
an idea between the just the name itself.
That buzz is really bad.
Came across my mind. Me and my buddies were just kind of sitting around a kitchen table, thinking about
so the party always ends up at the kitchen
table. If you had a restaurant, what would it be called? Like, what would kind of food would you make? Kind of thing. Just, I don't know. Just dudes and people hanging out. And we just kind of uttered out the name Punk Walk. At some point, it's sort of getting, like, we started laughing and it started getting passed around, you know? And,
no one was
and
like,
that's
kind of
where it started.
There
was Punk
Walk.
And we were like, oh man, that'd be so cool to do that. And we could like make our own noodles and blah, 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 blah. And it kind of just always was an idea. It never sort of came to fruition.
So just buddies hanging out.
Just buddies hanging.
What if it feels like a bunch of dudes hanging out? Yeah, that is.
I don't think that's ever happened
punk.
Before.
That is pretty
yeah,
punk.
That's
so.
True. That is the essence of punk.
Let's start with Nightcore. I think the epic part works really well as Nightcore, actually.
Okay. I'm gonna make it bend and break. Say a prayer, but let the good
times roll. In case God doesn't show. I mean, they are clearly trying to do Panic at the Disco at this part, right? But it's the wrongs that make
the words come to life. Well, I guess it's like, who made who, though?
Well, that's what I'm wondering, yeah.
Because wasn't Panic at the Disco, like, the other big Fueled by Ramon band? Well, this is good.
Yeah. Oh, I hate that I like this song.
Yeah, it's good. Fuck. Yeah, sorry, man. It sucks.
I don't know, like...
It sucks to be you.
Maybe they... Speaking of kind of... you know, Asian cuisine fueled by ramen, absolutely kind of part of the larger punk rock universe, I guess.
You know, there's been punk. What's the word I'm looking for?
Walk.
My brain just fucking stopped, man.
Punk rock. Is what you're trying to say?
No, you know, like, you know, where you appropriation, punk appropriation.
Mm-hmm.
We should move on.
All right, let's move on to Nate Wants to Battle. I don't know who this is. There's a lot of, like, really big budget covers of this shit. I'm gonna make you bend and
break. Hey, Nate Wants to Battle. I wouldn't want to battle him. He looks strong.
When did Panic at the Disco do start their... 2004. I mean, it still sounds like they're trying to be Panic at the Disco on this song.
That's a tune.
I hate these kind of... I think I hate most of the covers of this.
Yeah, this is so annoying. Also, Panic at the Disco was, like, signed to P. Wentz's label.
Like, I'm sure that they're, like, homies, and they're probably, like, you know, pushing each other forward. But it definitely, to me, sounds like they were like the, that sounds like the Panic at the Disco influence in the song, the orchestral, frankly annoying introduction. But that was Nate Wants to Battle. I don't want to battle him, I agree. But also, I'd prefer to just sidestep the battle entirely, if I could. Ooh. And move on to Thnks for the Memories, Jonathan Young. I can't read what any of this says. I guess gonna make it bend
and break. No, this is like a sort of...
Johnny Frank is kind of vaguely
like full t-shirt, like full print metal band, like the Warped Tour metal, mixed with... I don't understand this vibe.
It's a bad vibe. Bill Murray, Fortnite champ, 100, ass peach emoji, big schlong. And it says Bill Murray, spelled B-I-L-M-U-R-I. Well, that's what that metal writing says. That's the name of this band, is Bill Murray.
What?
Yeah, it's Johnny Frank is a singer, songwriter, is the main contributing member of alternative indie pop band Bill Murray. But it's like, former Queen vocalist and rhythm guitarist of metalcore electronic core band Attack. Bill Murray. That's the most fucked up band name I've ever heard of.
I'm glad FOBruary is over.
Yeah, I think... Mariana's March will be a lot less embarrassing for sure.
Marchianis.
This one is a metal cover. Oh, this might be the same song actually, because I didn't know that the last guy's name was Bill Murray. This might be a music. This is a music video for the same song.
So continue. Is
this a joke or not? Like they're having like epic wolf stuff and they're wearing like fake viper glasses and whatnot.
No, because I feel like this was like the end of the like Three Wolf Moon. This is a shame.
Calling your band Bill Murray so that it's like Bill Murray, but like I actually can't like I can't properly even like comprehend that this band is called Bill Murray. Like, that's, like, the most fucked up thing I've ever seen in my life, actually.
It's a struggle for me also, yeah.
My brain refuses to accept it, and I've been thinking about punk walk all day, and this is still worse.
And this is somehow, yeah, this is... I mean, I feel like also thinking about punk walk has sort of lowered your defenses, I guess, maybe. Right? Like, you're not capable of you know, it's like when you get a cold because, you know, your immune system has been suppressed because you're drinking too much.
Right, because you're saying that if you have a good immune system, you don't need to be vaccinated.
That's exactly what I'm saying. I'm just saying, why don't we talk about, you know, exercise, vitamins, you know.
You can get Bill Murray hot sauce. You can get a Bill Murray spud sack of potatoes. Hog Crankers Club tea. There's a Bill Murray Barbell Club Windbreaker Anorak. There's a lot of merch going on. I mean, there's some kind of level of self-awareness, but it's really hard to parse when there's still something very sincere about this as well.
It's just like, it's not good at being funny is the problem.
Yeah. Unlike us.
Yeah.
Here's the days ahead. I think this one is sincere. Sincerious. But this is also kind of the same realm of... Is it... Kerrang or alternative? What are they? What kind of music is this even?
I think this is alternative press music.
Yeah, probably.
Like these were bands that were on the cover of that show.
I do like this band because
not literally.
They're trying to look tough, but they have an unintentional kind of Walmart photo center look to it as well.
Yeah, totally.
They add like a lot of like under oak leads to it.
This is like maybe the worst kind of music.
It's so fucked. That's so cool. Do you think they have a huge breakdown? Also, we didn't really talk about how this actual song has a really stupid acoustic part that's terrible.
That is bad. That is quite bad.
Well, here we go.
That's where you're just. Ah! Ah!
The pianos. You know what it is, actually? The through line for all of this stuff is Pete Wentz swinging that bass around his torso. I mean,
that's true. That connects all of this.
This is the sound of the torso swing, absolutely. I'm curious what they do with the... Oh, yeah, I knew there was going to be a... Yeah, okay, we got to hear this part.
Okay.
It's so good. I actually love it.
Now it's good.
I heard the modem breakdown, I liked it.
Yeah. Well, that is the thing that music is good for.
Children of Modem can be a good band name.
Oh, wow.
Okay, I think we're into maybe vocal covers now. This is a vocal cover. Thanks for the memories. I don't know why it's not playing.
I saw you skipping around. I was like, maybe there's a particularly great part.
Maybe I'm going to play the punk walk video again. It's Alice Lake is the name of this. I think I really don't like the call and response vocals at the start of this song.
The beginning of the song is amongst the worst parts of the song. Outside of the back.
I think they really do. Yeah, they really make you earn that chorus. And maybe that's why the chorus seems so good, because it's been such a rough journey so far.
Yeah. Some great, like, fake rocking out.
Yeah.
With the guitar. The spinning really is like a key part of this band's identity.
Yeah. It's all about spinning and swinging. And also the word sweeter, I think actually I'm starting to sour on, ironically, because it's just the intonation of it. Sweeter! Sweeter!
I think I said this maybe in our first Fall Out Boy episode, like part of the problem of Fall Out Boy is people singing like Patrick Stump, which again is like fun in a bar, but like in a sincere vocal cover is like... quite disgusting.
It's true. Yeah, it's
true. I'm disgusted.
Well, this one by Takeover, the vocals have been edited a little bit, methinks, with a little bit of computer work. I also just love this dude.
Yeah, this is a great
spot. He's in a walk-in closet. I'm gonna make you bend and
bend. Wearing a big Monster Energy drink.
Yeah, he's sick. In case
God told you sure. Okay, this fucking rocks. To sort of demonstrate the different parts, you just sort of is pivoting in different positions around them. Like, I feel like I have the same Bluetooth headphones as this guy.
Oh, damn, really?
They're like a real, like, you know, best of the worst Amazon guys.
See, you know, is this part actually not auto-tuned and he's just really good at singing?
No, there's some...
He's... Because he's selling it. Very well.
Oh, yeah. Maybe auto-tune adds something.
I'm just scrolling down. These covers are so bad. Shout out to Takeover. That was sick. and also bad.
Kind of yeah, favorite, no. Combo. Yeah. So far.
Fall Out Boy Basement Sound Sessions with Dan Meyer. Did you see how he just appeared like that? Did you see how he appeared in the man cave like that?
Transported in.
Sick.
Is this a
unneeded somewhere? Maybe, I don't know. What? I'm gonna
make it, wow. This doesn't feel like a bar. Also, those are two different guys. Times in case God doesn't. There's no way this setup is like at a normal bar. This is someone's basement.
I think it's a man cave.
Wow.
Okay, so this is Dan Meyer featuring Justin Marugula.
So there's a full-on like bar that looks like a hotel bar, like just absolutely fabulous.
It's like they bought every single possible light on Amazon.
Yeah, and then but then there's like shitty stage lights that are way too low. Like if you were actually in this room, it would be horrible. Wow, I gotta get a basement like this.
Like the epic anime betrayal version of the song too.
Yeah.
Oh, look at this.
Why is it like this? Been looking forward to the future. My eyesight is going bad. And this crystal ball. Wow.
It's
always cloudy except for when you look into the past.
I think he might be making fun of us for watching it.
Yeah, I don't think anyone is being made fun of here. But I just like that it's treated and stuff, but then still like deeply out of tune. Like, this is incredible. Like, I cannot express that. You can put this on socials because, yeah, the production values of just the basement alone.
I'm kind of like a little bit tempted to make a FOBruary supercut, I also can't bring myself to like move on from this one.
This is changing. Me.
The thing about this guy is that like he's just an aggressively normal looking kind of guy. Like, he definitely like goes to work as an insurance salesman or whatever. No one has any clue that he's doing this with his buddies on a Friday night.
Oh yeah, he reminds me of like occasionally like people I've dealt with on like brand work where someone is like, you know, by the way, I actually am really into it. That's cool. I make videos my own.
God, Dan.
Yes.
Dan is my boy.
Dan is my man.
He's only done a few covers, really.
Wait, I don't understand, though, because there was another guy off the top, and then that guy just disappeared.
He came back towards the end. That was Justin. Okay. That was it was featuring Justin Marugula. So imagine arugula if it had arugula. It's like the lettuce, but it has an M at the start somehow.
Okay, I can imagine that.
I mean, what a cool couple of guys. I love them.
I want to hang out in that basement.
Well, up next is OMG, I'm a Lion, and I think this guy might actually work with these guys at the insurance office because he's doing a business casual cover of Thanks for the Mmrs. Nice little fade in to
slow fade.
Say a prayer, but let the good times roll.
He was dressed like a Twin Peaks sheriff there for a second.
He reminds me of someone that but I don't know his name. Maybe he's from TRL or something. Is there like an MTV guy that he looks like?
No, he kind of looks like Robert Patrick. Like he looks like the guy from Filter. He's not one of them's Robert Patrick and one of them's something else.
One night and one more time.
Great.
Thanks for the memories, even though they weren't.
He's giving it more of like a Jars of Clay delivery or something.
Richard Patrick.
Yeah, one more time. Thanks for the memories. Thanks for the memories.
I was thinking of Damien Fahey. Damien Fahey. Who is also on Family Guy.
My eyesight's going back.
So I was thinking about take a picture.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That is true. I was thinking of this guy. He's cloudy except for when you look. He's a very melancholy businessman.
Oh,
way.
I do not recognize this guy. Yeah, this
I don't really know how I know who that guy is, but
yeah, I know.
One night stand. One night stand.
One night and we're tame.
This is my favorite episode so far.
This is some good stuff.
This guy kind of, there's a lot of, there's a lot of metalhead YouTube this week.
Oh, yeah. What's the,
I can't read it. This guy's name.
But he's got his battle vest like hanging off the back of his chair.
His name's, this is his name, Horsty98,
just like Spider-Punk.
He's dressed exactly like
Oh, is it a... I believe it's a Glory Hammer shirt. One night and one more time.
Thanks for the memories that it was so good. Maybe... Maybe the chorus is like so triumphant that if you like Rhapsody of Fire or something.
Oh, maybe, yeah.
Oh, this man is so cool. Glory Hammer?
Well, I don't know that you think they're cool because alleged leak group chat suggests Glory Hammer are misogynist and obscene racists.
Glory Hammer, come on. You already
hit not a lot of glory and misogyny.
You've already
guys.
Nailed the green screen. I mean, this. This reminds me of the director of, Guardians of the Galaxy, James Gunn. You know, like you had such a good thing going here with all of your whole aesthetic and look, and then you have to, you know, be more careful online. You might think that you're joking, but you're hurting people, and now you have to pay the price, Glory Hammer.
That's true. Yeah, I don't know that Glory Hammer quite at the James Gunn. I was an edgelord excuse. It looks like they might be.
Oh, they're just full-on piece of shit.
Yeah, I think that might be the case.
I hate once you see the CW at the start of a Loudwire article.
Yeah,
you know, if they're gonna put it,
it's on. That's serious that's, shit.
Yeah. Okay. Well, fuck them and fuck this guy for wearing their shirt then, and also covering this song in general. Just do better.
There's a lot of a lot of marks against him, unfortunately.
Well, up next, this one I think will be good. This is Rich Kotel. just like how this video even starts with this Nate Roos looking motherfucker and this white dread person, and it opens with already a hop testing or something. I'm not really sure.
So to open it, kind of sounded like a Primus song.
Just goofing around.
Did you be friends with a white person with dreadlocks?
Hey guys!
I have been in my life before.
But what I'm saying is now, like, would you film a video? Like, if I had dreadlocks, would you keep doing a podcast?
Guys, before we do this one, I'm just going to point us out.
British white people with dreadlocks.
He's hard to sing like. So we're doing this one because we requested it loads. If I had my
loads.
Way, I'd probably not
loads.
Do it just because
British
I don't
YouTubers
attempt to be like him because he's too
We'd be getting
sexy.
Loads
Sweeney!
Of requests.
He's too sexy. Sweeney, you just basically shouted Sweeney. But here we
I
go,
think
here
you
we go.
Should get a white dread, Sam.
I'm thinking about it.
Ow!
I'm gonna make you Ben and Brittany. Say a prayer, but let the good times roll.
I think they were getting loads of requests because a lot of people are like, I saw the title and immediately freaked out. Thank you so much for covering Fall Boy.
Here's what I don't understand. He's like really holding on to this mic stand and singing, but this is absolutely a room recording. Oh, big cut there. Oh, is that? Oh, that's you flipping around?
I know, I'm wanting to think again.
Yeah, I think maybe the first take did not go well.
Which one are they? Or did they just perfectly cut it? Or?
I think so.
Wow. White Dread's hitting that A minor really well. So that's those guys. Yeah, also, like, that guitar's not going through that orange amp, is it? I don't think so. I highly doubt it.
No, I don't think so.
Also, in the music video, Patrick Stump, when he does the annoying acoustic guitar part, he, like, pretends to be playing it on his electric guitar. That little details like that drive me fucking crazy.
I was like, oh, why has it got to do? You know, Patrick Stump, I was getting to be on your side, you know?
Yeah. I mean, this one I think has some nice
cozy
vibes.
Zone.
Yeah, this is very
this is
cozy.
A kid hiding behind the couch. Got a cross on the wall for you.
and playing poorly. This is the band. This is the band everyone knows and loves, Abstract Falcon.
I thought it was a little brother behind the band, but it's just another bro.
But I love them.
Oh!
Oh, this is a nice night.
You want to know
Saturday night at home? It's definitely your grandma's house, maybe.
You know what else they covered the same night?
I don't know if you know. I don't know this song.
But this is it's not quite next month, Trench Timber yet.
Yeah, that's true. Let's just see if we
So wait, where's Alfred State College?
Alfred, New York. I don't think these kids are in Canada, and they've covered multiple Trenchies on their.
Turns out Marius Trench, a true popular band.
That's so disappointing.
Contrary to what people in the Discord were saying.
Here's Stephen Uwe with a...
Yes.
See, I think if... This is the best kind of a cappella multi-track video. It's not so slick.
Yeah, like a little. I want to see the edges, which I truly can see here.
That one, that one guy thinks he's slick in the headdress. This sounds so sick. It was kind of lo-fi. Fuck, it's good, isn't it? It's a good song.
Yeah, this is fucking awesome.
That's really disappointing. Okay, well, this one I also think is good because I was like, oh, this guy has the classic Fall Out Boy fan police line, do not cross guitar strap. So this will be funny. Well, turns out he's... Oh, no, this is the wrong guy. This guy doesn't have it. And it's really bad at guitar.
Yeah, I love it. I really love that tone, though. I feel like you never hear that tone.
Yeah. It's just like... Pete West probably likes that tone with his knobless bass. I mean, like, how old do you think this guy is, first of all?
I mean, a bit of a Stumpian kind of comb over, I think, happening there.
He has the
that's the hairline of someone in their late 20s, at least.
At least.
And, like, I'm being generous here.
And the decor of the home is that of someone who's nearing retirement, I think.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because I'm thinking there's a lot of binders and stuff.
Yeah, this is like a tax-doing nook. But I guess even when you're doing your tax... Maybe when I'm working on my taxes this year, I'll take a break and play this song.
You might shred, yeah.
So this guy kind of sucks doing the guitar. This guy with the police line, do not cross, like, look at that. Look at him go already.
Oh, yeah. Oh. This is like, do you ever, do you dance like this? Like, I don't like people putting this on the internet. It's why I find TikTok, like, performance videos generally uncomfortable. Oh, yeah. Do you while out on your own ever, Josiah?
I mean, I have before. Not for... I don't really listen to music on my own lately.
Oh, okay.
This guy's name is, I guess, Rintenzer. He's doing disembowelment, actually. R-N-T-T-N-Z-R. But I love how even the drum fills, he's like... He follows them with his strumming pattern. Like, he's strumming so much more passionately than the members of Fall Out Boy. He has, like, a really, like, art school-looking guitar. And it sounds so good. Yeah, he almost has Todd Killing's tone a little bit, but a little bit tougher. This guy fucking rules.
Oh, my God, yeah.
He seems so cool. He has a 1 hour and 40 minute video called Tour of the Rintenzer Guitar Cover Process. 56 views. I mean, he's taking it seriously despite a severe lack of views.
That guitar is cool, though. Like, I don't understand. Is only half of it painted and the rest is just the wood?
I know.
Like, has he chipped it? Because it looks chipped. It looks cool. Like, that's the thing.
He seems like a really cool guy. I want to hear one of his original demos real quick.
We should.
It's called Where I Lost It. It's a demo by Rent Tenzer.
That's not what I expected. But it is a close-up of his guitar. Like, he knows that the guitar is, like, what he has to offer.
I think he's trying to make slick pop punk. But he's, like, too rough around the edges, and it's making it way more interesting and cool.
Ah.
Even those drums are cool.
Yeah.
I love him. So shout out to Disemvoweling is actually not a good thing. It makes life very confusing.
I'm realizing now just how confusing it is if you have no sort of prior knowledge.
Exactly. So, but still, shout out, Rintons are cool, really cool guy doing his own thing. I love coolest. Him. Up next is Thnks from the Memories Fall Out Boy cover, but spooky, which really just means like vibey YouTuber girl. It's not very spooky, I don't think. Oh, actually, it has Prestige TV soundtrack drums. This is Jessica Rica, 192,000 subscribers.
I don't know that I'm spooked, though.
Mm-hmm.
Put a goblin in there.
I'm more like thinking like, no, I'm definitely not. I'm more like picturing like really, really bad After Effects collage of rolling waves and like hints of the characters. I'm thinking I'm going to hate this Vince Gilligan show a lot.
Yeah, totally. Like, should I watch Ozark? And you're like, no.
I will say people are not very gatekeepy on Fall Out Boy. I never see any negative comments on Fall Out Boy cover videos, and maybe that's a problem. I don't know. Here's a new thing. This is our patented Smule Smection now. I found a new Smule thing called Smule. Oh, this is the wrong video actually, but there's something called Smule Magic Piano. I don't know what that means. And it doesn't look like a video. Does this game look like Smule to like you?
No, it looks like
you pay for Smule
thing. Okay, so it's like a...
It's kind of like...
It's imperfect. This is like a rock band kind of thing.
It's like a rock band kind of thing. Maybe they just filmed this app and then uploaded it to Smule.
I think this feels like me...
It doesn't have the piano. Smule. It has the Smule audio compression or like the lack of... It has that Smule rawness to it, for sure. That sounds insane. God, this one is spooky.
Yeah, no, this should have been called Spooky. I like this, but I'm deeply unsettled.
Magic Piano by Smule is a music playing app that allows the students to learn the fundamentals of playing a piano. Okay, so this is a Smule vertical. WikiHow to get lots of smoolas in Smule Magic Piano.
Smoolas?
How to get free smoolas.
It's like crypto? Wow.
I wonder what the founder of Smule looks like. Just kind of normal tech guys.
Yeah.
Oh, I can add him on LinkedIn, though. I'm doing that right now.
Wow, when you watch ads for Smule, you earn 5 smoola. So wait, so Smule is the currency and the platform name?
I guess so.
And you can also get 5 smoola for connecting with Facebook.
Smule is so dope. The guy who, the CEO and founder of Smule, Jeffrey Smith, his LinkedIn photo is him with a horse. It's really cool, actually.
Damn, cool guy.
Did you add him? I did. He's probably not going to. I had to connect first, but I bet you'd have more luck than me getting in with Smule, probably. Oh, and yeah, now my LinkedIn says something went wrong, so.
Wow. This is, I would say, more a photo of a horse than of the creator of Smule.
Maybe that's the Smule mule, I just realized.
Jesus Christ.
Here's some more Smule of Thnks for the Mmrs. This is Ginger Schnapps and La La Bowler. Just so excited and terrified whenever I see that first slide.
They said you knew me without wings. Good times roll.
In case God doesn't show.
Let the good times roll.
And I want these words to the make things roll. Right.
But it's the wrongs that make the worlds come alive.
Who does he think he is?
Then that's the worst you got. Better put your fingers back to the...
You'll notice all of these.
So what are you gonna say? The guy kind of looks like a fourth Trump son or something.
You'll notice with all of the Smule vocal covers, Smule users couldn't handle the disemboweling. This one, they spell out thanks for the and then MMRS. This one's just straight up called Thanks for the Memory, spelled normal. Vivian DeOria and Murdoch Romez.
Do you think, like, some people have playback issues on Smule, and that's why they're so awful, or is that just...
I don't know, like, I don't understand how they make every single... Even when people can sing well, they just intentionally make it as difficult as possible. The lighting is always insane. You can hear, like, the chair louder than the voice, even though they're holding the mic up.
Who does he think he is?
This one is good.
Yeah, the guy on the right is like, looks like a ghost, kind of. So do you earn Smule by performing on Smule?
I think you earn Smule on Smule.
It's just one of those things.
Like, I think Smule is just Smule adjacent.
My eyesight is going bad.
The degree of sincerity that is oozing out of the woman on this is, like, making me so uncomfortable. Like, unblinking eye. At least the guy has sunglasses on. The eye contact is just starting to really weird me out.
Well, let's move on to this person didn't do disemboweling, but they did add numbers in place of vowels for some of it. This is Remedy Wiles.
The live version?
He's a really good singer, too, so that always adds extra layers.
American Eagle.
So much better after this show.
Oh, he even knew the... He even lip-synced the live
thing. Maybe it's like a...
I'm gonna make it bend and break. Say a prayer, but let the good times roll. In case
just giving the most here.
And I want these words to make things right, but it's the wrongs that make the words come to life. Who does he think he is? If that's the worst you got, better put your fingers back to the keys. One night.
Yes.
One
I gotta say, also, this guy has, like, my dream head shape.
Your dream head shape?
Yeah, like, because by the time you get to the bottom of his head is doubled in size.
It's true.
It's just a powerful head shape.
It's very true, yeah.
I think at the top of his head, that's the size of your head or my head. Well, I guess you have a weird head.
No, I have
head,
a
right?
giant head. My head starts big and ends big. It has no shape. But also,
my head is all the size of the top of his head. It's bullshit.
That guy was really good at singing, but Smule didn't help him with that. He was good at singing in spite of Smule.
And I know.
That's what I like about Smule, is it's just kind of the most unforgiving app. It's really like actively trying to sabotage every performance.
And that's, for sure. That's beautiful. It's quite cruel. It's a cruel app.
Okay, a couple left. This one is really exciting. This is a band that I love now as of press time. They're called Vinyl Playback. So before we check out this cover, I just want to just see if there's any other info about Vinyl Playback, because the reveal of the vocalist is really exciting. I just want to draw that out a little bit for you.
Okay.
So they're from Sydney/Wollongong. I don't think that's the same as Wodonga, but maybe it is the same. Maybe it starts with the same letter. Good enough for me. They've covered Smells Like Teen Spirit, like last week's thing. Yeah, I don't know. Five Sauce. This I don't really see what the vinyl thing is. I don't know why they're called vinyl playback. It says it on the kick drum, but this is what they do.
Okay, so it's because they're in a band room or something.
So instead of a vocalist or a bassist, he was just... I like that it's just a horn cover, but also with a real rock band. But it's not ska either. It's just like...
Yeah. Also, does the amp have like its price tag on it still?
Yeah. It sounds great though.
This is fucking awesome.
Vinyl playback rocks.
Oh yeah. This is my favorite one yet.
Oh yeah.
What is the, what is on the shirt of the guitar
player? It looks like it's Darth Maul playing guitar. Is that wrong?
I can't tell. I think you're right.
Doesn't that look like Darth Maul like doing a punk jump? Or maybe Maul. It's Slipknot.
No, I think you're right. I've decided you're right.
So that was vinyl playback. Okay, this is the, I mean, I just love this one because it's so cool. Genuinely, it's a cover on a kalimba.
Ooh!
For all the Konono number 9 heads out there.
What a cute setup. The sort of, there's a, the kalimba itself, of course, is quite beautiful. And then this, there's like a blue kind of table that has like some very cute accoutrement upon it.
I am noticing quite a painful hangnail on the right hand.
Yeah.
And it is kind of a POV perspective. So I'm feeling like it's my, I'm feeling like I, first of all, I have these beautiful hands. Second of all, that my right thumb is in a lot of pain right now.
Yeah, that looks uncomfortable. Looks quite red.
But anyway, so that's the covers. Well, let's end, let's close out with the Vitamin String Quartet.
Yes. So great.
So that's the end of February. It's the end of this episode. Thanks for the memories, Sam.
Thank you for the memories, Josiah Hughes.
Yeah, I mean, what are our final thoughts about it? Really, I don't know what to.
Great chorus. Still don't know how the verse goes. In general, FOBruary, what a gift. What a gift. And what will we think of next? I guess everyone knows it's Marianas Arch.
Yeah, it's true. But it's sure fun to talk about Fall Out Boy and just close out with some wise words from a friend of mine.
And I love it.
Enough. Did he change his location? He's outside now.
Maybe he's having a cig.
Yeah, fuck it. If it tastes good, come on down.
Well, I also think... like in the world we're in right now, it is a lot less rigid in like people need to fit into holes or to square pegs and whatnot. Like gender's a construct. We your kid is he's so cute.
You can come on, it's okay.
Pop off. Gender's a construct.
I had my kid on.
That's all part of this thing, man. Don't worry about it.
Gilbert.
She's been checking out the other computer, by the way. Watch this. Here, check this out. Watch this. Oh.
Oh, yeah. He switched devices.
She's been on
even.
This screen. Wow. Your other computer's still up. She's been looking at
this. See, I'm production value.
She's like, what's going on over here, Dad?
I love. They've won me over. I love
punk
rock.
You know what? I can't wait. Next time I'm in Nashville, you know where I'm headed.
That's my son, Gilbert.
Your son? I'm sorry.
It's all right.
Once fact, this is taken from an interview from 2006. If he was invisible for a day and could spy on a famous person, he would pick Vincent Gallo, because I bet he does interesting things. The craziest place he's ever had sex, not full-on sex, quote-unquote, was CBGB's downstairs bathrooms. And when he dies, he thinks he's going to be eaten by worms, but he would like to be cryogenically frozen. Wentz fact.
We've got Hayden from For Your Health here now to talk about Fall Out Boy, because you actually like Fall Out Boy. You don't realize this, but there's been like an hour of preamble for me and another guy who don't appreciate this band. But you are a Fall Out Boy appreciator, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so
I'm a defender.
Okay, so let's defend. I mean, you know, defend, it makes it sound like this is a contentious argument that we're having. What is your relationship with Fall Out Boy? When did you find this band? Did you ever have a difficult period where your love waned? Just tell me about you and Fall Out Boy.
So Fall Out Boy is like one of the first bands I ever got into. I'm 24 and I think I probably found them when I was like 11 or 12, you know, maybe a little bit younger. And just from, that's just like what was happening at the time. Like they were on the radio and shit, you know, fourth grade, I saw some of their music videos on YouTube. And I was just like, for whatever reason, it captivated me. And like, when I was first getting into music of my own, when I got an MP3 player or whatever, like I loaded it up with like fucking Soulseek, Fall Out Boy, and like Green Day songs, stuff like that. So I don't know why it spoke to me, but it's just something that like, it was like kind of one of the first things I got into, and it just kind of stuck with me throughout my life. I became like more seriously into them, I guess, like post hiatus, like when I was like 15 or 16 and they were coming back. That was like the first album cycles I got to experience like in real time after like sort of becoming a fan of them while they were on hiatus. I just kind of like, I had to pick up the scraps, you know, like I didn't have any new content. I just had like what had already been. And I was like, damn, I love this band. I hope they come back. And they did in like 2012 or 13 or whatever. And I've been following them since. Yeah.
So you're in grade. I love that. Cause like, I'm like just a little over 10 years older than you. And so for me, grade four was Green Day. Grade four was Dookie. And that was like a, you know, bomb going off. Do you remember the first Fall Out Boy song? Cause like, I literally remember being at a skating rink and someone making them play Dookie over the PA system. Do you remember like being in the fourth grade and what song you heard and like where you were? Is it just that they were sort of in your life because they were on TV and they were on the radio?
It's actually kind of similar. You know, I was like at like a school function, like a fun night type deal, and they had like a Dance Dance Revolution game set up like for PlayStation, and Dance Dance was one of the songs. And I heard it and I like immediately went home and I couldn't stop thinking. I like had to find everything out about them. It was like, that's like my first memory of like being excited about music, I think.
Was it, okay, so it fucking rules that you found this band through a DDR machine at school. Like that's just so perfect. Mm-hmm. Did you find any other music through DDR? Like was DDR at all a music discovery tool for you as a young person?
No, not really. Cause like I said, it was just like, I was just kind of like, it was this, they had some shit set up in like our sort of like recreation gymnasium type hall thing. And they just had various things set up. And I like walked into a room and there was DDR set up. And I remember seeing that. And that's like pretty much like that was it. I don't know. I didn't really think about anything after that.
I love the idea that For Your Health is like basically a result of like a DDR in the rec room gymnasium at your school. Like that is, that's a very sick trajectory. And I will, even if you disagree, I'm going to say that that's the story of your band.
Yeah. I mean, cause that's the thing. It's like, I was like playing, like I played in like band in school, like in grade school and high school and shit. I played percussion, and like my first instrument was drums. And so like growing up, I like idolized Andy Hurley, and like learning Fall Out Boy songs and shit was like how I learned how to play drum set. And like that, like they, like that's the band that like made me want to play music in a band.
That rules. And did you, because again, for me and for Josiah, who co-hosts this show, I mean, we spent years just talking about the songs of Blink-182 before we talked about all of them and then have moved on to other bands. And like for us, it was the kind of combing of the liner notes, the like, who are the bands that Blink was referencing that kind of took us further down a punk rabbit hole. Did Fall Out Boy have the same kind of effect on you?
Definitely. Like, it's funny to say even, cause I don't think about this stuff all that often, but like when I, as I'm being asked this now, it's like, it sounds really corny to say, but like, I think I owe a lot of the trajectory of my life to like discovering Fall Out Boy because of like the type of band they are, you know, like they come from the hardcore scene and like, you know, some of them were like vegan and straight edge and shit. Like that's how I discovered like those subcultures, like being in a culture desert that I grew up in rural Ohio, you know? So it's like, I think I discovered like veganism and straight edge through like Fall Out Boy and like hardcore for that matter, like looking into like Race Traitor and like Arm Angelus and shit.
That rules. Have you ever, you know, had a chance to meet anyone in Fall Out Boy? I mean, like, I feel like Indie Hurley is at every show, like already, you know, we're a week into this. When you and I are speaking, we're a week into FOBruary right now. And like everyone has a story about seeing some Andy Hurley band where he just like hangs out at the merch table.
I wish. I've been trying to get us to play with Sect for, but it's like we kind of like COVID has kind of been a thing for like most of our existence as For Your Health. So we haven't really had a chance to play shows for the past couple of years, well, year and a half. But I met them at a meet and greet like a long time ago, for like 5 seconds, and it was like I was so happy.
Did the other members of the band share your enthusiasm for Fall Out Boy?
No.
No, they all hate it.
The way, like, one of the ways that we sort of sometimes try to find guests for this show is that we'll search the band that we're talking about just on Twitter and people we follow. And I feel like For Your Health had more Fall Out Boy tweets than like any other person or band that I follow. So like in a lot of ways,
that's just me.
That's just you. And so is the rest of the band like shut the fuck up about Fall Out Boy, or do they just accept that that is a passion of yours that they have to kind of live with?
So I think it started as shut the fuck up and they moved on to acceptance.
And you ever try, I mean, I guess you're right. I mean, I don't think I really thought a lot about how much, in particular, if you're like a newer band, so much of your band's lifetime has been through COVID. So you probably don't have like a ton of being in the van, being mad about other people's music taste. Experience, but have you tried to like indoctrinate them at all when you've had an opportunity, you know,
a little bit
in a long drive?
I'm definitely annoying about it. So like I say like we haven't had that much time because of COVID, but it's like so we started in late 2018. We played a couple of shows at the end of 2018, and then we played 100 shows in 2019, and then like didn't get to do much since, you know, then. So it's like we did tour a lot that first year, and we're kind of just getting back into it. So like we have spent a lot of time in the van, and I'm usually the one wearing headphones because my music choices people do not enjoy.
What else do you want to put on that no one else in the band will tolerate?
I honestly, I don't know. I just like listen to like I think one of the things that's kind of funny about our band is like there's massive age difference. Like I'm the youngest one by 7 years. And so it's like Damien is 34, and our guitarist, and like Johnny and Mike and Rosa, like all the other members are all in their 30s, early 30s as well. So I'm kind of like, I feel like they grew up like, you know, when they were coming up and shit, like they were already past the point to get into that stuff. They were adults and they were like, fuck this. and they're too cool for it. So it's like, like me being a little bit younger, like that was like what I grew up with. Like you mentioned growing up with Dookie and shit. It's like, I mean, for me, it was like, it was like third album Fall Out Boy. So it's like, I don't know. They most of them kind of hate it, and that's fine.
Yeah, I guess you kind of have to accept that at some point. That is for sure. If I was in a band with somebody who wanted to listen to Fall Out Boy as a person in their mid-30s, I would be like, you have to put on headphones. I'm sorry. it's just how it goes.
I mean, you have a Blink-182 podcast.
I know, but somehow those things are completely different to me, and I don't understand it, and I cannot adequately articulate the difference.
So I've tried. This is funny that you kind of say that, because Damien, I've tried to bridge the gap a little bit, because you know what's funny about it, we kind of come to this agreement that kind of knocked down some of the pretension or the pretentiousness. Was that like he always talks about Saves the Day, you know, he loves Saves the Day. And I was just kind of like the first two Fall Out Boy albums are kind of like Saves the Day, right? Like, well, and I don't know. That's, he just was just like, at first I was kind of like in denial of it, because he was like, yeah, like, well, they're kind of like a ripoff of Saves the Day. And I'm like, oh, wait, so like you like Saves the Day, but you don't like the band that's trying to emulate them? And then he was just kind of like, I don't know, whatever.
I could totally relate to that trajectory. Because, yeah, like I'm exactly of the age where I love Saves the Day and I love Through Being Cool. And literally just today on Discord, someone was like, I don't understand. I know, like, Sam, if you like this, you know, and like they're just trying to do Jawbreaker. I don't know that they're trying to do Jawbreaker, but it definitely sounds like they're trying to do Saves the Day. I'm like, I like Newfound Glory. Like, it's not that I have good, cool taste in music. I like dorky, fucking poppy shit. I don't know. I don't know what it is. Maybe by the end of this month, I will have like fully interrogated myself adequately.
I think you got to bust down the walls. It's a mental block, I think.
That's what I'm doing. Well, this is like real exposure therapy for me over the next like 3 weeks. So,
yeah.
So we'll see. You know, you mentioned a meet and greet. Like, I assume you have seen Fall Out Boy live. Like, what was the first time you saw Fall Out Boy live like?
That was actually my first concert. Was seeing Fall Out Boy and Paramore. And it was at a festival called Bunbury. It takes place in Ohio, but it was really cool. It was just really, I don't know. I was like completely overwhelmed, because like literally, I don't know. The first time I had seen any musicians perform live and in a real setting, it was like an all day thing, and it was hot and gross, and there was a billion people there. So it was like a little overwhelming, but it was also like super magical, because it's like, I don't know. I had like these romanticized ideas of like live music and shit, and I'd never gotten to go to like any shows or whatever, because like I grew up in the middle of nowhere, so it's like I didn't really get to start going to shows until I was like 18. I don't know, I just like I fell in love with live music, and I just like kind of decided like I wanted to do music stuff. I don't know, after that I just went to like every show that I could, and you know, I drive hours multiple times a week to go to concerts and shows and shit. And before I like moved to Columbus, where there was stuff happening, and I don't know. That experience definitely like confirmed to me that like I want to do something with music.
That rules. This week we are talking about, we're ending off FOBruary with Thanks for the Memories. Do you have any particular feelings, perhaps memories of this song? Where does this song sort of sit in your, you know, personal Fall Out Boy tastes and opinions?
I don't know. It's a classic. I don't know that I have a particularly strong connection to that song specifically. I'd say that like my favorites with Fall Out Boy like come and go in waves. Like, I think for the longest time my favorite Fall Out Boy album was Infinity on High, that's you know, that song is from. but I like it kind of shifts around. So it's like I guess I have that connection to it, that it's like a part of like my favorite work by them.
How do you feel about the like really extravagant pop stuff that kind of started happening, I guess, post hiatus? Because I know some people we've talked to weren't into it. Personally, I kind of like love some of those individual songs, like just the grandiose kind of like totally unmoored from anything related to like punk shit. Did you continue to follow them there, or are you more of a like first couple of records fan?
No, I respect that band. I know this is a really unpopular opinion, but like I totally have just followed them on the journey, like to every aspect, like even up until like that latest album they dropped, Mania. Like I went and saw them on that tour, and I think I have like 3 copies of that record. I don't even necessarily like listen to it, or like I'm super familiar with the songs, but like I don't hate it, and I appreciate them for like what they are. I think like Fall Out Boy is really interesting in that like they're like more popular than they've ever been in their career, even though they have so many naysayers. And I think it's because like they just continue to like evolve, and the same thing happened with Paramore or whatever. It's like those bands, like they're able to like still like do stadium tours and shit. Like I mean, that I don't know if you're familiar, but that Hell and Mega tour that happened recently with Fall Out Boy and Green Day,
it's crazy.
Like that shit was crazy. Like they're bigger than they've ever been before, and I think that, like, I don't know, they're doing them, and that's fine. And you don't have to like it. Like they're not making music. Like if you liked them when you're 20 years old in like 2005 or whatever, like you might like, I don't know. It's, you probably grew out of it. It's, they're doing their own thing. It's fine.
Honestly, I love that the you know, like centuries again, all the stuff that I think sometimes people shit on are, what's the like, light it up, like that song is fucking great.
Yeah, I really like that album, Save Rock and Roll, and the one that came after, American Beauty, American Psycho. I'm not crazy on the latest one, Mania, but mm-hmm. I like post-hiatus Fall Out Boy. And like I said earlier, like those are things that like I got to experience in real time, so I might have that nostalgic connection to them.
Yeah.
But like I enjoy both of those records as pop records. and I think if Fall Out Boy continued to make the same like pop punk stuff for 8 albums or whatever, it'd probably be pretty boring. I mean, I remember, like, I don't know. It's just like when bands are bands for so long, and like they write about or like make music similar to that they were making when they were 18. It's just, it's disingenuous and a little creepy.
Hey, speaking as someone who had to talk about new Blink-182 material, I actually could not agree with you more. Where you're like, why?
Yeah, I remember when California came out, and even as a teenager, I was just like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah, so amplify the way that you felt by 10 years. It was a disconcerting experience. You know, I mentioned finding your passion for this band by searching just people that I follow on Twitter. Because you do seem to tweet about it a lot. Do you feel like, do your Fall Out Boy tweets get a lot of activity? Do you feel like in general, the For Your Health fans are here for Fall Out Boy takes? Or, you know, sometimes you just tweet shit because it's a thought and no one fucking cares.
So to work backwards through that, I frequently just tweet whatever I'm thinking. It's kind of bad. I don't care. I don't know that a lot we have, there's a lot of crossover. I think that there's something interesting because like, I think specifically like at least on the like For Your Health record that we did in spite of, it's like, there's like a lot of like mall emo influence as much as there is like metalcore and like screamo and stuff. So I think like there's definitely people on like both sides of the spectrum that like we are maybe the heaviest band they listen to, or like the softest band that they're frequently into or something, you know? So I don't know. I think that like, there's definitely a little bit of crossover there.
You mentioned though that sometimes you tweet off the cuff too much. Have you ever gotten in trouble? You know, I feel like I remember you going back and forth with a lot of people like during COVID. Like, it seems like a very COVID thing to just be like, there's nothing I can do but tweet and then have people get mad at you. Like, what's the worst thing that's happened to you on Twitter?
Well, Twitter isn't real. So yes, I don't really consider it like a bad thing happening to me, because like, I don't know. It's like, yeah, at the end of the day, no matter what happens, I just like, I'm just playing video games while like replying to people. So it's like,
okay, so no, that's correct. But I guess more what I'm saying is, what's the most mad you've made people on Twitter?
Oh, I don't know.
What's the highest level you've got to in the video game of Twitter?
I don't know. It's hard to quantify. It's like, I don't know. I think a lot of people like just like think I'm an edgelord or something, but I'm like, I'm not like trying to make people mad. Like, I don't seek out replies from people. Like, so I think like a lot of people like that aren't accustomed to like my sense of humor, like, just, I don't know. It's, they're the same type of people that get really mad about shit on the internet. I don't know. It's like, you gotta pick your battles. Like, I don't know. You're not going to change. Like, I'm not going to change anybody's mind about something, and they're like not going to change my mind about something. Cause like, if it was important, it wouldn't be happening on a, in the replies of like a band shit post.
Yeah, I think that's fair. It's just never tweet, the forever rule, or tweet, but you know, just don't respond. I don't know.
I mean, I don't know. I think the Twitter is completely at this point, like almost separate from the actual band's life. Cause frequently people tell me, yeah, I've never listened to your music. I just like your Twitter. And I'm like, okay, that's cool. Thanks. Can you listen to the music too?
Can you please? Like, you know, eventually we'll get there, I'm sure. You know, the pandemic's still going. Yeah. It's long. Is there, okay, so this is the, you know, prestigious promotional spot on a podcast. Where can people find you? What should people do if they want to yell at you on the internet? What do you have, you know, to promote on a Fall Out Boy podcast, Hayden?
Oh, well, all of our social ats are at For Your Health OH. We just put out a remix album recently. It's on streaming. You can check that out, For Your Health, In Spite Of Two. We have a release coming out sometime soon. I don't know. I can't talk about it because I don't fucking know. But I probably in the next couple months. Yeah.
Hell yeah, man. Thanks so much for your time.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
This is the last reading of the month from Pete Wentz's live journal, July 19th, 2005. Wrote you a goodbye note. You just wrote me off. On your arm when you passed out. Best friends, ex-friends, better off as lovers, not the other way around. Racing through the city in the back of yellow checkered cars. The takeoffs are the worst, but the skin from your shoulder to your ear makes it all worth it. And I'm sorry the way my moods flicker on and off like an old light on your porch, but I know you wouldn't have it any other way. Sneaking in your window instead of out. The way you hold a cigarette because you don't know what to do with your hands when we're sitting this close. The way the waist of pants feel better at the ankles. The way you always were my best excuse for calling in sick on everyone else. I miss you. Petey.
Some way to quote this song. I'm sorry. Every single song is about you.
Can't let February go without doing like a bonus. So this is the bonus one. Tuesday, August 29th, 2006. I pack heat like an oven door. As I run away from everything I have ever known, just whisper in my ear, and the tears come streaming down your face, when you lose something you can't replace, when you love someone but it goes to waste, could it be worse? Lights will guide you home and ignite your bones, and I will try to fix you, high up above or down below, when you're too in love to let it go, but if you never try, you'll never know, just what you're worth, lights will guide you home. So obvious, so much more brilliant than I could ever imagine to be. Be bright and shine. It's dark. I'm sorry I've come so off course. Tell the pilot to clear us to land in your backyard.
The Complaint Department. 155 Podcast. The Complaint Department. 155 Podcast.
The Complaint Department. 155 Podcast.
Aw, poor listeners. Oh, you just want to complain. Oh, you didn't think about me.
Here's the complaint this week.
Hey, this is Althea. My complaint for the complaint department this week is that I feel like Seamus has backdoored themselves into a regular segment on the pod, and nobody asked for that. If I wanted to hear Seamus's opinions about stuff, I'd ask them. Thanks.
I mean, that's the thing about the complaint department is you could do anything with it, really, and we might play it and make fun of you. But Seamus was the only one to think of it. And maybe Seamus should get their own segment on the pod now, where we just catch up with Seamus and talk about Irish Celtic punk bands once a week or whatever.
Ooh, that would be what's new in Celtic punk? We should do punk news and then Celtic punk news. It's just like, what the fuck is Flogging Molly up to?
Yeah, I mean, that's going to be Seamus's new thing. So thanks a lot. And Althea, because you were second to this, you do not get to have a segment. So sorry.